in Afghanistan about 5 years ago. This was exactly the kind of place that I envisaged the work of the forward-thinking, modern, contemporary art space for what I thought, I hoped would become a fairly forward-thinking piece of socially engaged art. So it's a brilliant place, and it's a fantastic team. It's been a real effort, a great positive effort over the last few weeks, months, years in coming to this point. So I'm really grateful to Rima. And it seems fitting that we launch the exhibition on the 11th of November, with this being Armistice Day, and also to coincide with the withdrawal of the British troops from Afghanistan. So that long war in Afghanistan is over. I'm thinking inverted commas because we still got people there. But it seems important to me that something on from the First World War, we have stories from soldiers from the front line to illustrate what it's like to be human on the front line. And I think when you see the work, perhaps to reflect on those letters from the trenches 100 years ago, which was very much in my mind when we planned this particular project. I also want to thank, I think you won't like me for thanking him, but I want to thank Colin McGowan, who he and I met in Afghanistan in 2011. I was an official war artist embedded with British troops in Helmand. And I spent a month in the front line, and one of the remarkable people I met in Afghanistan was Colin. I met him again earlier this year. And between meeting Colin the first time and meeting him the second time, something happened to Colin. He was blown up, and the determination and the resolution that he had shown, that I've seen from him since we first met, is extraordinary. So thanks for coming, Colin.
Thanks for having me, Derek. Long drive.
Long drive.
Five car pilot. But,
what was I trying to achieve in this project? But I had to keep reminding myself, because when I got invited to be a war artist, what I was going to do wasn't very clear. It was quite open-ended. And I didn't want to be a traditional war artist or to try and repeat things that had been done before. And you know, the history of war art goes back 150 years. They cover painting scenes from Waterloo and various other battles, long after the event. And I was very conscious that a lot of war artists, they tend to go into a war zone and then they might do some sketching or they might take some photographs and do the work back in the studio, normally back from the UK. And I very much didn't want to do that. I wanted to find a way to understand what it's like to be on the front line and then to create the work there and then on the front line. So the idea of taking, it sounds ridiculous, explaining it to you, the idea of taking Big Brother-style diary rooms to the front line of Afghanistan was the idea. When this was first discussed within the military, most of the people didn't want to do it. There was rebellion against the idea of this project. People thought it would lead to mutiny and shootings. And so I met with a lot of opposition, but I had a very good sponsor who was an army officer who really believed in this. Through him, I guess the vision that we both had about the project would make it happen. So I ended up in Afghanistan with hundreds of coloured postcards, and I went to three different parts of Helmand, which the military chose for me, and they chose the places that were the most dangerous, and they didn't tell me this until I got there. And in fact, I didn't really know that until I got on the ground. But the military thought that places that are most dangerous, though the stories would be the richer for it, and some of us would have more to write about. And I remember the first time at the patrol base, I turned up at on day two on the front line, and it was a group of Royal Irish Rangers. they said, oh, we've been here 3 months and we've been under fire 87 times. And I kind of did a quick calculation in my head, and I thought, well, probably we're going to be attacked for our year as well. And in fact, whilst I was there, a patrol from that regiment was attacked nearby. So it was a hostile place. But it benefited me in some ways, because I had to, in order to get the stories from the soldiers, I had to patrol to them. They couldn't all come to the diary room. So mostly I had to go to them and ask them for their stories. And because I took the same risks as them, I felt I had permission to ask, I had the right to ask. And also because I didn't have very much time to ask for these stories, they didn't have much time to write them. So I would have 20 minutes or half an hour before I moved on. And so I didn't give them postcards to say, you know, have a think and then let me know tomorrow what you think. I said, listen, I'm going in 20 minutes. You need to write the story down. And that really worked, because I wasn't looking for reflective statements about what it's like to be there. I was looking for honest, raw, immediate accounts of what it's like to be on the front line. And the other thing that critically I was looking for was not a British or Western view, but a person-centered view, really. So, you know, we engaged with Afghans as well, interpreters, Afghan soldiers, any civilians I encountered. Basically, anyone I came across, I gave them a postcard and said, write down your story of what it's like to be human on the front line. So these diary rooms, they started to fill up, and I suddenly realized that people are writing things, and they're writing with a real intensity. And I saw people fighting as well and shooting, and I noticed that they wrote the stories with the same intensity with which they fought, which to me was a very powerful statement, a very powerful engagement. And I hope that when you see the exhibition, you get a sense of both the diary room itself, and here in Eagle we have created the sense of the diary room. It's not a shipping container, it's a space that you go into. And in that space we have collated those hundreds of stories that were written there and then in the front line. And to contextualise the diary room, we've got a number of photographs I took and some film footage that I took as well, which we've edited with Viva. And those photographs and film footage really contextualise the stories I have. So when you're in that diary space reading those stories, you get a sense of place and a sense of a person. So the person that wrote that story is also firing that gun, I guess in other words. And that to me is quite important, the duality of the soldier who can fight one day, but the next day can sit down and write their story about their missing their friends at home, or how they're reflecting on their mother's battle with cancer. And all of these stories were written out there. There was a phrase that came up in one of the stories, which is two wars. There are two wars being fought here. One which is the bombs and the bullets that we're familiar with, and the other is the war that goes on in the soldier's head when the fighting stops. And you know, that was a phrase that was completely unknown to me until I went out there. And I learned so much from what other people were writing, and that particularly summed up the project for me. And what I was trying to tap into was the kind of the unconscious second war. What is it that people are thinking about when the fighting stops that they don't want to mention to their friends because it would betray a weakness, and they don't want to mention to their family at home because it would frighten them? What is that thought in? And I hope that you'll see that this project has gone some way to capture those thoughts, and in doing so perhaps will change our perception of war and what it's like to be a soldier on the front line. And that to me is an important element to this project. The other thing that I'd like you to do when you go up is, once you've engaged with the work, then there is a chance for everyone to write their own reaction. So the idea of a confession in a diary is extended to this particular exhibition. And we hope over the course of the 3 months that we will collect hundreds of thoughts and reactions from people who've seen this. And those thoughts might range from the mundane to the extraordinary. Therefore, I'd be very interested in your thoughts and your written. to go along with the exhibition and the book that Speed published about the project just arrived this morning. It arrived about 2 hours ago. So we have a book to go with the exhibition, which is a book that has been produced in with the support of the Arts Council and also in support of Combat Stress, the Veterans Mental Health Charity, where proceeds from the sale will go to that. And the plan, I think, is that once you've seen the exhibition, then I'll perhaps do a book signing down this space over there. And if you'd like to go to the bookshop, and if you want a book, I'd be very happy to sign it. The book has a number of the stories from Afghanistan, a number of those photographs. It has an extraordinary postscript of Colin's kind of wisdom. And it has an amazing introduction that a soldier who wrote one of these stories in Afghanistan who was then killed, his mother has written the introduction to that book. So feel free to grab a book and we'll do a book signing. But the link to combat stress, I think, is important because to go back to the idea of two wars, I think the silent injury that is post-traumatic stress is something that Combat Stress is seeking to tackle along with other charities, and the legacy of the war in Afghanistan, as well as the legacy of the war, the Great War, the First World War, is the damage done to minds as well as bodies, and I'm very keen to support that charity as well. So thanks very much for coming. Hope you enjoy the exhibition. I'm